Good morning. I'm Dr. Samin Sharma from Mount Sinai Hospital, New York. I'm Director of Interventional Cardiology for Mount Sinai Health System and Senior Vice President of Quality and Operation, and also the Professor of Medicine, Cardiology. So I will be talking about a very peculiar phenomena which we observed during this COVID-19 pandemic, and that is the incidence of cardiovascular illnesses, particularly acute and STEMI, really plummeted, significantly reduced. So I'll go through the reports, the publications, and the possible explanation for this phenomena in my next 20 minutes lecture. The topic of discussion today will be the plummeting incidence of acute cardiovascular illness and STEMI during COVID-19 surge. As we know, that we have noted significant reduction in acute cardiac symptoms. And the question comes down twofold, that are they truly reduced? As the collateral benefit of change practices and behavior of COVID-19 containment strategies, or they're underreported as a subset is dying or having MI at home. Your patients are not coming to the emergency room or hospital due to fear of contracting COVID-19. So this is a very interesting topic. And I will try to put this into these four important points. One is the reported incidence of STEMI during COVID era, then respiratory illness paradox, the possible explanation for the reduction, and future perspective. The first point, that is reported incidence of STEMI during COVID era. So first report actually came recently, but there have been now numerous reports of 30 to 70% reduction in the number of 9/11 activation, ER visits, and STEMIs coming to hospitals globally from New York City, USA, Spain, Italy, India. Now, this is the study from 9 very busy centers from United States of the cath lab activation in this COVID-19 pandemic, and where it used to be 25. Activations per month per site went down to 15, so 38% reduction. So truly, less patients are coming for emergency activation. Excuse me. So then the second report is from Kaiser Permanente, Los Angeles, and showing that with increasing COVID patients coming to the hospital in last 2.5 months, there has been a significant reduction in acute MI compared to the similar time period in 2019 to current, 38% reduction. Another report from Italy, that total number of daily admission of from MI from used to be 18, now went down to 13. And of course, corresponding to significant reduction in both STEMI and non-STEMI, anywhere from 24 to 30%. Now, another report also from Italy, which as we know very heavily infested with COVID-19, showing up to 50% reduction in MI, STEMI about 26%, and non-STEMI almost 65% and so. At Mount Sinai, we noted the similar incidence of non-STEMI as well as STEMI in last 1 and 1.5 months compared to 2 months prior. So clearly, there has been a significant reduction in STEMI and acute cardiac illnesses. And that was the story of in the New York Times, that amid the coronavirus crisis, heart and stroke patients go missing. And we actually give various explanations, which I'm going to discuss subsequently. There's another report has come. So not only the cardiac, but these are the data from Cigna, that there is a significant decline in hospitalization for serious conditions, various acute disease process. Of course, MI and stroke are the lead, but acute cholecystitis, the appendicitis, any acute processes have significantly declined. Is it because of better food, better taken care? All need to be seen, but there has been a 50 to 80% decline of the various insurance claims for the acute disease process. And we know elective procedures have been postponed. So therefore, one fact, yes, there is a clear-cut reduction in acute coronary illness and STEMI. Now, second comes point is the respiratory illness paradox. Now, what is it? We are well aware that during the influenza season, any respiratory illness, you have a higher acute cardiovascular illness as well as MI. And this actually has correlated in many, many studies. This is the study from Canada, that during influenza, the first week, there's 6 times higher admission for MI compared to after 1 week. Now, this similar pattern is seen for other viral illnesses. And as shown here, that this is time dependent, that you have early viral respiratory illness and you have a higher myocardial infarction subsequently. The question always comes, why that is? Well, this actually happens to the patients who are predisposed. They have the thin cap fibroatheroma, which is a vulnerable plaque. And those which have a fatty macrophages cause rupture of the plaque, causing coagulation. There is a damage to the endothelium. And of course, various other factors which can give rise to this rupture of the plaque and causing type 1 MI. During this process, during respiratory illness, people have fever, they're coughing, they're tachycardic. So there is also a type 2 MI which occurs. So both of have resulted in higher MI rate during the respiratory illnesses. But what we found, that while COVID-19 is a predominantly respiratory disease, but we found a decrease in acute cardiovascular illnesses during the COVID-19 surge and pandemic. The question is, what are the explanation for it? So therefore, the most important presentation or part of the presentation here is that the COVID-19 implementation strategies are likely contributing to the observed reduction of acute cardiovascular illness and STEMI in the following ways. And I'll talk about these 4 factors one by one. First is marked reduction in air pollution and nitrogen oxide, decreased vehicular traffic, airline and factory exhaust, the reduced chemical and gestatory triggers of cardiovascular disease, overall relaxed lifestyle, and improved mental and physical health, and better medical compliance, because people are very relaxed now. And then lastly, that underreported, as a subset of patients are having ACS and STEMI and dying at home, but not going to the hospital because of potential for COVID exposure. So we'll go one by one. First one is the pollution. Clearly, studies have shown sharp decline in air pollution because of there is very little road traffic, airline flights, factory exhaust, all are closed. So they have led to our clear sky, as shown in many of these pictures, which I'm sure many of you have seen. Very important, this is the India Gate in Delhi. Look at this earlier last year and now here, so clear. So clearly, the air quality has improved and pollution has gone down. So we also know that Global Burden of Disease Consortium has estimated 4+ million premature death because of the air pollution. And this actually was a classical example of the Great Fog in London, where there was excess deaths during that time period. Now, also shown that there is directly proportional increase in cardiovascular mortality when the fine particulate matter, which is 2.5 PM, increases per 10 microgram per meter cube. And of course, air pollution causing the higher cardiovascular events. So one study showed that people living near the major road have a high calcium score. And many times, the higher exposure of this particulate matter can cause MI within 2 hours of their exposure. So this actually, there is a very nice state-of-the-art review on air pollution and cardiovascular disease by Dr. Sanjay Raja Gopalan, and he goes through various factors. One, the historical epidemiological data, and taken the impact of the air pollution into development of cardiovascular illness. So air pollution has been one of the important factors, has been shown in numerous studies associated with global mortality, and relationship of air pollution to various phases had been shown in zone 1, 2, and 3, most important being that it's a well-characterized adverse cardiovascular effect causing cardiac and cardiovascular mortality with air pollution, besides having development of various risk factors and other disease processes of diabetes, hypertension, thromboembolic diseases, and so on. So it is the particulate matter of the 2.5, which is really seems to be the culprit. Of course, the higher particulate matter also matters, but 2.5 is the most common particulate matter which is available in this pollution, along with the nitrogen oxide and ozone, and all actually have shown that based on the country you live, there is a global now increase of the PM2.5, as shown by this heat map. And of course, black areas are the one where there is very high concentration. And these are the India, Bangladesh, and various areas of the Africa and so on. So also, that higher the concentration, it is considered by the WHO standard that in the unhealthy the environment. And those are the countries are having high incidence of cardiovascular disease. Classical being India, Bangladesh, and various South Asian countries. Again, another slide depicting the acute particulate matter 2.5 exposure with mortality, very linear relationship, also acute ozone exposure. So seems to be that air pollution directly correlate with the cardiovascular mortality. So now, what happens? How does it do it? The harmful effect of the air pollution are triggered by reactive oxygen species generation in the lungs with consequent activation of pro-inflammatory signals such as CRP, IL, and causing endothelial dysfunction. And this actually had depicted very nicely in the central figure that the air pollution causing the oxidative stress and various biological intermediate and translocation intermediaries causing the damage to the endothelium and of course subsequently rupture of the plaque, and largely manifested by particularly who are at cardiometabolic risk disease and with the increased respiratory the reactive oxygen species production as well as inflammation. So now we understood air pollution, more MI. But what if there is a decreased air pollution, are you going to have lower MI? Well, this reverse association holds true. We do have few data. One of them is actually classical, is from 2008 Olympics in from Beijing, where during that time, all heavy emission vehicles were banned and power plants were shut around that area. So what they found, significant reduction in 2.5 particulate matter concentration, 50% reduction in nitrogen oxide, and which translated into 8.8 reduction in cardiovascular and respiratory mortality per 10 microgram per meter cube decrease in PM2.5 concentration. So therefore, your lower the particulate matter, lower the pollution, lower will be your cardiovascular mortality. This actually data from the Massachusetts. Also from MI point of view, the which percentile the air pollution it is, 65, 70, 85 percentile, as you can see here, risk of MI 1.9%, 2.7, and 6.9 increasing when your air pollution increases. So your air pollution decreases during times, MI mortality or MI admission actually decreases. So seems to be it's a clear cut both in reverse as well as the prospective relationship. So this leads to that what has happened now with our containment, the COVID-19 strategies, that house containment, house shelter, travel restriction policies, all have led to reduced air pollution, nitrogen oxide, cleared skies, and in turn have resulted in dramatic reduction in plaque rupture in such a short time. And this is the key, that why this happened so clearly, because we have seen that particulate matter increase within 2 hours associated with MIs and cardiovascular illness. So therefore, reverse is also true. We decrease very rapidly. We saw decrease in overall MI. Now, second point was the reduced chemical and gestatory triggers of cardiovascular diseases. What does that mean? We all know the studies have shown that consumption of fast food leads to substantial endothelial dysfunction that acutely impairs vasodilatory function, assessed often as reduced brachial artery flow mediated dilatation. We also know that increasing the triglyceride by, of course, eating fatty food, it leads to mitochondrial oxidation of free fatty acids and production of systemic reactive oxygen species, which take away the nitric oxide and impairs the endothelium. Also, during this time, we have seen high salt intake. This can cause rapid rise in blood pressure, and that is related to or cause many of the cardiovascular illnesses. So it seems to be that endothelial dysfunction and this hemodynamic protuberances may participate in acute event of STEMI by causing plaque rupture. And the fast food meal, or you know, we call fast food, basically is causing endothelial dysfunction. And the data have shown that it associated with lower brachial artery flow mediated dilatation. And this was the very early experiment that healthy volunteers were given high fat fast food. And you see rapidly there is a significant reduction in the flow mediated vasoreactivity, while it did not happen when the low fat food was consumed. And this actually happens more for peripheral arteries. Another study, the same way, that the fast food meal associated with a lower brachial artery dilatation, which lasts for a few hours, and that concentration of triglyceride is associated with significant reduction. Increasing concentration of triglyceride, significant reduction in brachial artery flow mediated dilatation. Also, the study have correlated the frequency of the fast food intake with the cardiometabolic risk factors. As you can see here, whether you're using 1, 2 to 3 per month, or 1 per week, 2 to 3 per week, or more, 4, that your hazard ratio continues to increase of developing the cardiovascular mortality by eating this the fast food. So clearly there is a relationship besides developing other factors like diabetes and hypertension, and so that proportional higher mortality with these fast food intake. Now, the salt, also the high salt, as you can see here, the high salt intake within few minutes give rise to reduction in the flow mediated dilatation. So high salt intake, which we know many times can cause acute cardiovascular illness, has a basis that by causing the endothelial dysfunction. Now, one good advantage which we have seen is the importance of exercise. So this is actually graph showing that this is a high fat meal, this is the normal fat. So clearly there is a change in brachial artery diameter when you use high fat, decreases. But if you do exercise, you see, not only you attenuate, you actually dilate. So therefore, even if you eat fast food, it seems to be that exercise is your friend and should be done to avoid the bad effect of the fast the food. Now, this actually puts it together that the healthy endothelium has various protective effects in our body, most important being the endothelial-dependent vasodilatation, nitric oxide production. But all these food, fatty food, and the risk factors cause production of the reactive oxygen species, decreases nitrous oxide production, so therefore works against our healthy endothelium and becomes unhealthy. So therefore, the chronic consumption of fast fatty food can contribute to development of atherosclerosis and cardiovascular diseases, while decreased nitrous oxide bioavailability manifesting as increased risk of cardiovascular disease, hypertension, diabetes, and subsequent plaque rupture. So this actually is the important phenomena which we know well established. Now, what happened during COVID-19? Well, reduction in visits to restaurant, fast food places, and pubs contributed to our better eating and drinking habits and avoidance of extra salt. So therefore, this all acute changes of hemodynamic changes which we were having all have been avoided by using by the new the policies that people are making, staying at home and creating and cooking at home, hopefully with the better the salt and fat. So third point is the relaxed lifestyle with improved physical and mental health, and the better medical compliance, and the reduced spurts of vigorous exertion. And I'll take you through this. So we know that home containment has resulted in less work-related stress, and increase in indoor physical activities has reduced trigger of plaque rupture. Everybody is relaxed. They have now less traffic, so less irritation driving. So where many times the blood pressure goes to the sky when you get into the traffic, you are late for your office. So now relaxed style. So now you're putting your time to yourself with the recreational leisure time, regular exercise, yoga, meditation, prayers, and partly they all have contributed indirectly or directly to the reduced incidence of acute cardiovascular triggers and promote heart healthy milieu. Now, also we know that many times you don't have a time, but one day you have time, you want to do more exercise. And the studies have shown that the spurts of vigorous exertion and exercise is associated with the plaque rupture. So I think because you are doing daily exercise now, or more favorably, people are doing, so this spurts have decreased and also translated into a lower acute episode. Now, what about the relationship with a healthy lifestyle with the years lived without major chronic diseases? And chronic diseases are cardiovascular disease, hypertension, and so. So this actually very nice study. It took the healthy population who did not have any baseline disease at age of 40. And they actually worked on four factors as the lifestyle factors: BMI, smoking, leisure time, physical activity, and alcohol consumption. And each point was given 0 to 2. You're good, intermediate, or bad. So basically, the score could be from 0 to 8. So key was that, of course, you're a non-smoker, that the BMI less than 25, more time in the leisure time, physical activity, and alcohol consumption with the limit, all can give rise to a better score. So what was the relationship? And relationship was very clear, that if you have the best score, that you can add so many years of your life, as you can see, disease-free years from the age, could be additional 7 to 10 years, and whether it's a man or the woman. And you can see here, you have one factor, more than one factor, can add about 4 to 5 years of disease-free in your life after optimal lifestyle factor modification. So this really points down to that, change the better lifestyle, you're going to have a less chronic disease and more acute plaque rupture. So therefore, the patients are more, another point which we have seen is that now patients are more likely to be compliant with their medication schedule at home, especially elderly patients getting extra family support and care. This practice will likely avoid blood pressure fluctuation and interval angina episode due to missed medication doses. You know, many times patients are very busy, they don't take their medicine, pressure goes up, or pressure sometimes goes down because they take too many medication, and then they develop acute illness. So the acute episode of cardiovascular disease. So those things actually have decreased. Also, the huge convenience of newly adopted telemedicine and telehealth may actually be helping in this matter too, by avoiding time to travel to see the physician and use that extra time to take care of themselves, relax and do exercise and so. Now, of course, there is a negative part of it. If these relaxed lifestyle, staying at home, leads to your the basically job termination or reduction in salary, may create the mental tension, the depression, and maybe even suicides in the future. But this had to be very positively looked into it, that once this all lockdown decreases, that most of people go back to their work. So last point on this issue is it possible that, of course, some subset of patients are not seeking medical assistance and are succumbed to acute MI and cardiac arrest at home. Therefore, what we're seeing, MIs and cardiac issues, they're underreported because they're dying at home. So why? Because they're all worried about going to the hospital and getting from the emergency room or from the hospital with the developing COVID. So there is some credence to this concept. Now, this is the data from New York State back in first week of April. As you can see, before that, of course, now, because of COVID, there have been a significant increase in mortality. Each day used to be 35, 40. Now it becomes 600 during that time period. And more importantly, at home used to be 20 deaths per day. Now there are about 200 deaths per day, 10-fold increase. Now, question is, who are these people? So many of these patients are COVID, but many of them are cardiac patients who developed MI and had a cardiac arrest and died. We'll never know exactly till the long-term data will be available. More medical examiner reports will be there. So it seems to be that because of concern of the COVID, many of our cardiac patients died at home and developed acute illness. Now, this is another data from New York, New Jersey, that during this COVID time, while there has been an increase in overall death rate, in the time period, and it's contributed not only by COVID, but also with the heart disease and so. So this is actually additional about normal 6,000 deaths, which was shown in the New York City area compared to the earlier time. And many of these deaths occurred at home. So it means that, yes, there could be perception of the decreased MI and acute cardiovascular illness could be false because they're truly dying at home. So that has been a major, major concern. So we all know that while coronavirus kills people, but heart disease still kills more people, and very, very important aspect. Now, why also this happening is that because of concern, many people are staying at home. They're presenting late in the hospital. So what has seen in Italy, very interesting data, that case fatality, which used to be 4%, let's say last year, of MI, now has become fourfold increase of STEMI to 13.7%. And so it seems to be that why? Because people are coming late. They're developing more major complications. So this is a bad part of this COVID containment strategy, that people are concerned, don't want to go to the hospital and having acute cardiovascular illness and dying at home. Although I still have to say that it is unlikely that this could account for 30 to 70% decline in cardiac related EMS call or MI, which has been published so far. So key is, but still we need to be worried about this aspect, very much concerned. So the face of this trend, we have urged to the public to be cognizant of telltale sign of heart attacks, and that they must seek medical assistance if acute symptoms develop. Do not delay, because staying at home, having acute coronary syndrome and MI is worse than going to the hospital for some concern of contracting COVID and so. So there have been we all know there was a national news about putting off the elective procedures, but clearly each case has to be determined that can it be postponed without hurting the patient, so that patient will not deteriorate during that time period. And therefore, most of the hospitals have a very close follow-up of these patients, that if necessary, they were called in to have the heart procedure, even during this COVID-19 pandemic time. The nice pictorial by ACC, which emphasizing that don't ignore your heart symptoms, especially if you have a heart condition. So therefore, call 911, whether heart attack or stroke, very important, because that will save life, not to worry about the corona exposure in this situation. So this actually, the graph puts all these things together. That is the COVID containment measures, so the physical, mental stress reduction, healthy eating, less air pollution, and of course the COVID-19 infection causing opposite, endothelial dysfunction, systemic inflammation, autonomic dysregulation, because working through various hemostatic thrombosis, vasomotor abnormalities, and hemodynamic perturbances, and which used to give rise to acute cardiac events. It seems to be that with the COVID-19 containment strategies has worked favorably to reduce all these factors. Now, only one thing which remains is that are these acute events not reported? So it means more patients dying at home. If that is happening, that's a really bad thing. But hopefully, with enough education, that number will go down. So therefore, if I had to put together percent of each of these four factors contributing to overall reduction in perceived cardiovascular illness and STEMI, I would say air pollution will be 50%, chemical gestational triggers will be 25%, relaxed lifestyle and improved mental physical health 15%, and underreported STEMI and dying at home will be about 10%. So we conclude that we must respect the non-pharmacological means of environmental behavioral modification, which can play an important and significant role in reduction of or accentuation of acute cardiovascular illness and STEMI. And we have seen it dramatic within a few weeks of starting COVID. So we must encourage patients to recognize the symptoms of heart attack and acute coronary syndrome and seek urgent attention when necessary. Avoiding acute care, even during current COVID, the crisis, pandemic, is never a good choice and therefore should not be done. Very, very important message which we need to give to our patients. So therefore, now the last point is the future perspective. What we learn, what we should be doing, because COVID is going to finish soon. We already numerous areas within United States as well as other globally, the number of COVID patients have significantly declined. So therefore, we need to learn from what we noted so far. So therefore, the COVID-19 containment strategies leading to reduce acute cardiovascular illness and STEMI should continue beyond the current era by adopting the modified dietary, personal, and mental behaviors. Regular exercise, use Fitbits, 10,000 plus steps, calorie burn counts and balanced meal need to be enforced. Aggressive means to reduce air pollution should be implemented and be enforced by the national and governmental agency to avoid fines in the post-COVID era. Very important that we need to work on the air pollution. This is a modified the slide from Dr. Raja Gopalan, which I have put made it simple and added few of my own points, that it need to be done both as a society and governmental intervention level as well as personal level. Of course, from the society point of view, we need to work on various the plants and transmission of the vehicles. So clearly the power plants, low polluting renewable energy, and of course zero emission or low emission vehicles, natural gas, gas and electric gas cars, very important. So we need to work on those. So they should be made cheaper so more and more people can use it. Then of course the urban landscape reform, emission trading programs, and empowering government and civil society to work on various aspects of pollution, less of pollution in the industrial, the areas where there is public, though all industries should be far away from the city, and all those will help to reducing the air pollution. And then at the personal level, that is the wearing face mask, using air purifiers at home, outdoor, exercise and healthy diet, preventive medications, avoid commuting train, daily with the taking the your car, use the train, so the common vehicles, and so those will help in reducing overall air pollution. Now, aggressive compliance or the risk factor modification should become the integral part of our life and should be rewarded. Just like people, those who have best driving record have a lower the premium, their policy premium. So by lower insurance premium for people with adequate risk factor modification, compliance, regular exercise and balanced meal need to be followed. Second, public policies to clearly report the calorie and salt contents of the fast and restaurant foods need to be enforced. We know that in the packages, the food packages at the grocery store, these things are clear. But they're not clear when you are in the restaurant. What is the calorie you are getting in the fast food? So those things are, they're started showing it, but need to be more well enforced. Then higher taxation on smoking and alcohol may further reduce their consumption. And all these continuation of what we learned from the COVID-19 containment strategies, if we continue part of it, I'm sure we'll have a better cardiovascular health and better prognosis of cardiac patients. Thank you.